right, good evening, everybody. It's late. It's getting dark, but it's not quite as dark as it used to be at this time. A few weeks ago, even a few days ago. Shkia is getting later and later, already after Shkia. But today was the yard site of one of the most beloved Hasidic saints, the Holy Rebbe Reb Zusha from Anapoli, the Rebbe Reb Zisha, depends on how you pronounce it. Where he lived in Ukraine, they probably said Zisha. But it's possible, I'm not sure, how they pronounce it. But anyway, I just want to share a personal story, the Didi Hava Uvda, about the Heilig Rebbe Zisha. So when I was a chosin, a few months before my chasana, I was zeiche to make the very popular pilgrimage to Uman for Rosh Hashanah, to be by Reb Nachman Breslover for Rosh Hashanah. I actually davened in the tzion there with Reb Itchamaya Morgenstern Shlita. I davened in his minyan. I remember MBD was there. Mordechai Ben David was there, sitting a few seats away from me. And that's where I figured, I'm not one of these people who's going to go to Uman every year. It's not my style. I would like to visit another time. But to go away for Rosh Hashanah, I'd rather be Rosh Hashanah with my family and my own shul, personally. But I'll open up to Likutei Maran, learn a little bit, be by Rabbi Nachman. I know the Maranayim and Rabbi Nachman, maybe they get along, Baha'i Alma, but my Rebbe from high school, Moshe Weinberger, said that Tzaddikim only have machloikas in this world, but in Yenevelt, they're sitting together learning. That's what he says. He said it about two other, one big tzaddik and someone else I can mention. It kind of offended my wife that he said that. Offended me a little bit too, to be honest. But okay. Ba'amich kulam tzaddikim. We can't fault somebody. But in the Likutim on Chanukah in the Maranayim, it brings that if you learn the svarim of the tzaddikim, it's the same thing to be mishtateach al kivrom. To go and make a pilgrimage to their grave. You can make a mental, spiritual pilgrimage by studying their teachings. And the many teachings we could talk about, the Rebbe Zusha, the famous one that probably everybody knows, is that he once said about himself, he said, I'm not going to be worried about when I get to the next world and they're going to ask you, why weren't you Moses and why weren't you Abraham? But when they ask me, why weren't you Zisha? That I'm afraid of. Why didn't I live up to be me? To live up to my full potential. It reminds me of the story of the Netziv. That he was going to go work for a living. Because he wasn't going to make it in learning. And he had a dream that they showed him all the svarim that he was supposed to write. They said, where are these svarim? I said, what are you talking about? He said, you're supposed to write these svarim. So he decided he's going to be very diligent in his learning, and he became a Gadol HaDor. So anyway, and that's the question we all have to ask. Why weren't you Zisha? Why weren't you Joe Kulikowski? Why weren't you whoever you are? We gotta be ourselves and live to our full potential, and it's it's not easy to live to our full potential. That's the hard question. So anyway, when I was there in Ukraine, I was zeicha to make pilgrimages to Berdichev, very special to be by Levi Yitzchak Berdichev on Erev Rosh Hashanah, to be by Senegoria Shal Yisrael, plan on spending some time with the Berdichev. With this course I'm going to be giving, I'm really trying to make proper hachonas for that. And I'm nervous about it, to be honest. I don't feel like I'm worthy to be presenting something like this, but b'mokom shein anosh mishtadel yosish, and that's the whole thing, is to, the place where there's no men, try to be a man. You got to work to be a man. And so that's the thing. Maybe, this is one of these times when I'm being asked, why weren't you Zusha, and I have to sit down and do this. Rebbe Zusha, so anyway, I was by the Bardichever, I was in Mejbidish, by the Baal Shem Tov HaKodesh, and by all the other tzaddikim that are buried there, the Degel Machner Ephraim, and the Baruch Meshbitzer, and the Abderov, they're all buried there. And then that was Erev Rosh Hashanah. And then on the way back, it was in this, like a sherut, they call in Israel, one of these buses, but it's not really a bus, it's like a little bus, like maybe 15 guys can fit there. And we're on the way back to Kiev, and everyone's talking about Ukraine now, so I'll talk about Ukraine. So we were Rosh Hashanah and Oman, and we were on our way back to Kiev, and we're going to make two or three stops on the way back. Probably one of the main reasons that I want to go back to Ukraine is because we made two stops and didn't make three stops. And that's what the story's about. But not just me, but other people felt this as well. So on this bus, most of the boys there were regular Hasidish Bachrim who were making a pilgrimage, and regular normal Hasidish Bachrim. One was maybe a little bit more Eifke Klert with Frum, and the rest were just regular Chassidish Bachrim. Not big Chanyokish guys, but regular, normal from Chassidish Bachrim. And then there was me, a Baal Tshuva, and an acquaintance of mine who is a Ger Tzedek. He's a convert. He lives in Williamsburg, and he's from Oklahoma. I think he's a Cherokee Indian ancestry. And then there were two other Bachrim there who were not observant. One was like a Heverman, kind of a gangster type. I think he grew up with Lubavitcher. And the other one was from Rockaway, but also not really... And when I say a gangster, I don't mean a criminal, but like kind of like he had a certain attitude. And the other one was more Edelbacher, but not Frum, not the Shomer Shabbos, not Shomer Ter Mitzvahs. At one point, I was talking to him, and he said, "Well, I'm not religious." And I said, "You're not religious?" I said, "Maybe you're not observant." And I was just saying, this is what my Rashiva said, My Rashiva said, he was a Bacher, a German, he was observant, but until he met Rav Avigdor Miller, he wasn't religious. Rav Avigdor Miller made him religious. By Rosh Shiva, he was Rosh HaKol by Rav Avigdor Miller in Young Israel. And Rabbi Miller turned his life around. I mean, this guy, Rosh Shiva was always Frum, but I'm saying it made him, like, really care about it, not just going through the motions, because that's how he's raised, But, he's FFB, but, he became, he was a social worker, he had his master's degree, but then he decided, he has a lot of time. He was Mayor Lindsay's Koilu, as a social worker, so he had a lot of time to learn. So he was able to finish Shas a few times. Now he learns, something like 15 blot a day. There's Shiva. So, anyway, now I heard he became Rosh Hashiva Emeritus. Anyway, but that was, I stole the line from Rosh Hashiva that the Azai, that the know, that I said to this bachur, I said, okay, so you're not observant, but you're religious. That other guy who, like I said, it was a little bit more like, you know, he's a frum, Borough Park guy, you know, but like, you know, not chanyokish, but like frumer than maybe the other bachurim who were the more like Williamsburg bachurim, but he was like, you know, he was, you know, a little bit more knowledgeable in the world, a little bit more worldly. He was very misspelled by what I said that. But it's true. I mean, you're going to pick up and make a pilgrimage to Ukraine if you don't believe in anything. He's a religious guy. He's not observant. All right. You have to be both. That's what Shiva said. He said, you have to be both. But this guy was one and not the other. A lot of people are observant and not religious. This guy was religious and not observant, right? And really, in the Sfarim, it comes out that it's more important to be religious. You know, you have to be observant, officially, right? But we all mess up. So you do tshuva. But if you could always do tshuva on the observance, but if you don't believe in anything, how do you do tshuva? What hope do you have? You know, that's why Samarov says that's the whole pshat, which says, you know, that it says, Ola b'machshova, that liver is oilam b'midas adin. And why do we need to know the havamin of a Kodesh Baruch? The whole point is that the machshava has to be b'midas adin. But ma'isa, there's b'midas arachamim. We try our best. Well, sometimes we fail. We got to try our best. But the thing is, we got to be honest with ourselves. We're trying our best. But then, and then when we fail, that's b'yad Hashem, really. And if then you become an ishbitzer afterwards. You can't be an ishbitzer before you do the avera, but afterwards you have to be an ishbitzer. So anyway, that's hard. It's harder to do, right? It's easier to be the ishbitzer before you do the avera. To be an ishbitzer chosid before you do the avera is very easy. But after the avera, that's when you're supposed to. You're not supposed to be an ishbitzer chosid before you do the avera. You're only supposed to be an ishbitzer chosid after you do the avera. But it's easy, you know what I'm saying? Anyway. But you know, we're bogged down, you know, and we have a hard time. Medav zichen amikva, you know, Samarov said you have to have medav haman amikva and tash. Anyway, so this kid, he said he's not religious. I told him you are religious. You're just not observant yet, but you're very religious, you know. So this kid, so we were on our way to Kiev, and we go to Polnoy to the Toldos. And then we go to Shpetivka, to Pinchas Karatzer, and I was from all the Kivir Tzaddikim in Ukraine, I had like an intense spiritual experience in Shpetivka by Rav Pinchas Karatzer. Epis by Rav Pinchas Karatzer. I don't know what it was, although a little bit. I know my wife's a Gioris, but one of the Dayonim on the Beis Din was Rabbi Shapiro Zecher Levracha, whose father was Karatzer Rebbe. He's Ben Acher Ben from Pinchas Karatzer. So I could say shtickle. My wife's a shtickle of Karatzer Einikel, you know, and in a certain sense. And then the other interesting thing was my one of my daughters was born on the yard side of Pinchas Karatzer. So by us, Pinchas Karatzer is a big. We're big, big fans of Pinchas Karatzer. And so hard to see. I don't know. But anyway, so I was very misspelled. I don't know what it was. You know, I had no idea, you know. But now I see. So we have a cashier to Pinchas Karatzer, you know. And in the siddur I have from Tulsa from Yitzchok, it has in there a little tefillah that Rav Pinchas Karatzer would say, Rabbeinu Shalom, Necheni Bederecha Emes. He said, Master of the Universe, in your grace, guide me in the path of truth. And that's a thing we should always be praying, Rabbeinu Shalom, Necheni Bederecha Emes. That I was saying already for a while, so maybe that had something to do with it, to have that Kesher to Pinchas cards already then. But the thing was, I had already, I felt a Kesher to Levin Sigurdichever, to Rabbi Nachman, but there was something there by Pinchas cards I felt spiritually I couldn't describe. You know, I mean, one of the few, I've had, you know, intense spiritual experiences going, making pilgrimages to different Kivrei Tzaddikim, and often unexpected. You know, one was by Maharal in Prague, who I didn't know at the time was my Zayde. And Maharal in Prague, that was just like, you were standing, I felt like I was in a different world. One was by Rabbeinu Kodesh, by Rabbi Yehuda Anasi. So, anyway, I have to tell this story. I'm wasting my time. So this kid, so we were planning also to go to Rebbe Zisha, but because some of the Bachrim, they had to catch an earlier flight, we weren't all on the same flight, so we didn't have the Gelegenheit, we didn't have the opportunity to go to Rebbe Zisha, Heilige Rebbe Zisha. And this Bacher who said, he said, I'm not religious, right? This Bacher, the not religious Bacher, right? He said, he was crying. He said, we have to go to Reb Zisha. I said, what difference does it make to you? You'd say you're not religious. He said, but I don't know these other guys. I know Reb Zisha. And one of the Bacher in there said, what do you mean you know Reb Zisha? I understood what he meant. I understood what he meant. Because we all know Reb Zisha. And if you don't know Reb Zisha, get to know Reb Zisha. Because, what's taking so long with a school bus? So anyway, which bus is this going so late? It's not at Monticello Central School. Why are they coming home at 5:30 at night? So anyway, that's the maisa that I wanted to share about the Rebbe Zisha B'nidiha B'ovda. That this Bacher, who said he's not religious, said, I don't know these other guys. I don't know who's Reb Pinchas Karatz, or I don't know who's the Toldus. But I know Rebbe Zisha. So Chussi Yagin Alein Aval Kli Yisrael Amen. We should all be zeichet to know all the tzaddikim, and most of all know the one, because you know the ma'aser of the Rebbe Zisha. Let me tell you this ma'aser. This is the ma'aser Rabbi Weinberger would always tell us. So ma'aser was, there was a man came to Rebbe Zisha and he said he had these horrible dreams about his father. Who had passed away, and Rebbe Zisha told him, he said, look around the grave of the father, and there might be some item there that you have to remove, perhaps a coin that has an idolatrous image fell out of someone's pocket, and that for this reason you're having this image of your father holding an idol or something, and it's a disturbing dream. And they went and they found the coins and they cleaned up, and then the father came back in the dream without the idol, and he thanked him for cleansing his grave, removing the whatever was problematic from the grave. So the story went far and wide. The whole world heard about this Mephis from Rebbe Zisha, and it got to the ear of Hagoyne Chosid Mevilna. And the Gaon, the Vilner Gaon, said, the story is not that incredible because the Yerushalmi mentions this, the Jerusalem Talmud mentions this. But what I'm more amazed is how does someone like this, he heard of Rebbe Zisha, he knew who he was, he heard of him, he wasn't an anonymous, he was already a celebrity. He said, how does someone like this know the Yerushalmi? You know, it's rather obscure. So then that word also spread that the Vilner Gaon said this, and it came to Rebbe Zisha. Vilner, and they said Vilner Gaon is amazed. Said, how is it that the Rebbe Bzisha knows Yerushalmi? So the Rebbe Bzisha says, he will always talk in the third person about himself. He said, Zisha doesn't know the Yerushalmi. Zisha knows where the Yerushalmi God is from. So, we should all get to know the Rebbe Bzisha. We should all get to know the Vilner Gaon. We should all get to know all the tzaddikim. But most of all, we should know the one that they all knew, who's our Father in Heaven. That's who we all really have to get to know. It's nice to know the tzaddikim. Certainly, that's part of our tradition to venerate these saints. But more importantly, is the one that they all worshipped, is the one that we worship. And we can get to know God by learning from their example. And in this way, we should be zoiche to have a good kibben shiur. This is the anniversary of the night I spent in jail. So I was talking to my wife about a little bit. I mentioned some of the guys that work in the prison. And, you know, she said, you know, as difficult as that was, whatever it was 10 years ago, I spent a night in jail. I remember the court case. The first court case was on Yad Kislev, and the second court case was on Beis Shvat. So they're both auspicious days, and I remember going to the Baron Teitelbaum, to Satmar Rebbe, and talking to him about my case. And Rebbe said, you have to be more careful. You have to have gedilt. No, that's what he said. You have to be patient. Why are you speeding? You have to have patience. And then I said to him, I said, Rebbe, I said, it's nish gevein a problem at gedilt. It's a gevein a problem at zahiras. It wasn't a patience issue. I was really just pushing, not paying attention to what I was doing. The car started shaking, and I realized, oh my goodness, I'm going 105 miles an hour. I'll slow down. And I got the ticket, and I didn't get locked up that night. They gave me the ticket. I had to go for a hearing and a trial. I went to the hearing. Everybody was pleading guilty, so I went to trial. I also plead guilty. I didn't know what it means to make a plea bargain, this and that, so they threw me in jail for the night. And even there I knew it was a spiritual thing. But my wife says, look at this now. You're ministering to other people in prison. It's like the Misa with the Chernobyl Magid. I mean, not with the Maranayim. You know, where Roch Lameinu came and said, this is so you can have, you know, and the same thing. You know, one of the inmates, said to me, he said, you know, I really respect you, Rabbi, that you come here, the rabbis and the priests and everyone, they're coming to visit us. And I said, what's the big deal? I'm getting paid. This is my job. He said, yeah, but still, you don't have to do this. And I said, yeah, but it's a better job than a lot of other jobs. You know, I love my job. And he said, yeah, but you know, you're lucky that you're, and then I said, you know, it runs in the family. My father was a cop. My Zayda was frum. He was a parole officer. My Baba, Aleh Shalom, who was frum, she was Aleh Shalom. She was a nurse in Rikers Island, working in the prison. That runs in the family. It's the family business. So then the inmate says, "Well, you're lucky. You're on this side of the bars and not that side. Most of our guys are not behind bars. They're in the dormitory." But this guy, we happen to be where he's housed at the moment, was in behind bars. And I said, I was there once. I spent a night in jail. And this is the anniversary of that day. So I guess I got out tomorrow. So maybe tomorrow I have to make it tonight already. I guess I can make a Suda Saidoa. But the Suda Saidoa is not just, you know, because the year later I said something. I said, I have to make a Suda Saidoa because when I got out of jail. And then one of the Bacharim, who was really involved in the whole Maisa, because I was speeding on a trip where I was driving this Bachar home to visit his mother in Silver Spring. I was a Rav in Richmond. The Bachar was learning yeshiva. And so I said, I'll do a mitzvah. I'm going to drive Sam home to visit his mother. And the Because she wasn't feeling well, and he had bad news about her or something. But Hashem, she's okay. And unfortunately, his father was nifter, you know, when we were there in Richmond. But anyway, that was all of a sudden. But I said to him, you know, a year after the mice, I said, Sam, yeah, I said, oh, we should make a suicide dose. And when I got out of jail, he said, you're not the Baal HaTanya, you know. It's not what to make, you know, that a suicide dog because he got out of jail. So then, but then the Maisa, it's a suicide dog because HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave me the eyes to see so I can have compassion on other people. You know, one of our Jewish guys just got out and, we feel happy for him, and we hope he doesn't, you know, he's on parole. We hope he doesn't come back. A lot of guys wind up, you know, coming back on parole, whatever. It's Baruch Shalom Shavu Rachmanis and everybody. We should all learn to be better and do tshuva and turn our lives around. And well, thank you for listening to me ramble on if you made it this far. God bless. Please like, share, and subscribe. Comment. And the schus of Rabbeinu Mishal Mzisha ben Meryl Manipoli, schus yagalanim kol yisrael amen. We should all be zeichet to all kinds of hashpoas toivis and to simcha and to emuna, to erlichkeit. You know, I'll tell you one more thing from Rabbi Mzisha, because it says in the Hallel, it says in Psalm, what would that be, 115, I'm thinking. Yosef Hashem Aleichem, Aleichem Valbanechem. Maybe it's 116. It's one of those. May the Lord increase upon you, and upon your children. So the Rebbe Mzisha says there's nothing superfluous in Scripture. So why does it say, may the Lord, if the Lord should increase upon you, Hashem should increase upon you, Gevenlich, we understand that to mean, that he should, you know, make us more, you know, we should have children. So why does it say, Aleichem Albanechem? So I emphasized Reb Zisha and said, no, Yosef Hashem Aleichem, the experience of having a relationship with God, that should increase upon you. That we can say, Rede Aleichem Al Banechem. That should be upon you and upon your children. And that's the bracha I give to you on this earth. That Hashem should increase upon you and upon your children. Amen. Oh, my mother's here. All right.